So now we'll understand the concept and features of electric current. We know now flow of electric charge under influence of potential difference, or as they say, under influence of electromotive force, is referred to as electric current. And the charge would always flow from higher to lower potential. If potential difference here is more, and if at this point it is less, so the charge will flow in this direction, and this movement of charge under influence of potential difference is referred to as current. Now let us understand, to have electric current in a circuit, what do we need? As we say that it is flow of charge, so we need first of all the charge or charge carriers. In the material through which we need the current to flow. And the second condition or second requirement would be potential difference. So now if we have charges that are available to move, that are not bound by other forces, and they have an unrestricted movement opportunity, and now if they are provided with the potential difference, their spontaneous or their natural tendency would be to move from the higher potential point to a lower potential point, and this is how a current flows.
And
so the same concept is to be stated in form of Coulomb force. We would say that the charge, if let free, will tend to move, or there will be a natural tendency of the charge to move spontaneously in the direction or in which it is experiencing a Coulomb's force. If the Coulomb's force is trying to move it in this direction and it is allowed to move in this direction, this is referred to as electric current, and this way the charge is going to lose its potential energy and the charge is going to move from higher potential to lower potential. Now friends, until now we were doing like, you know, we have a source charge and we have a charge. There may be attraction between these two charges, there may be repulsion between these two charges depending upon the charges. They are of same type or they are of opposite type. So now, instead of having a system like this, we can also say that if a charge is here which is positive in nature, and we put another charge which is again positive in nature, and we put another charge which is again positive in nature, and so on, we have now many charges. We know this is against the natural tendency of all these constituent charges. How do I say that? Because initially there was no charge, it was a free space, so the first charge did not have any attraction or repulsion. But the moment I introduce second charge, that will be repelled by the already existing first charge, and we will be having repulsion for that introduction of second charge. So we will do an external work. And we will do more, because now it will be harder pushing the third charge, and so on. So the more the same charges we try to create in a close vicinity or a system, we are trying to put it in the way we are giving them external energy. And when this external energy is given, where is it going? It is increasing its potential energy, which means this region is now at higher potential, higher electrical potential. In other times, we can say that if let free, any of this charge would try to come out from this box, because there is a natural tendency to move apart for all these positive charges. So if let free, if this charge is given this opportunity to come out or to set apart, they will try to move apart. This itself means that all these charges are at high potential with respect to their neighboring points, because the charge would move always from high potential to low potential. And you can also say that the charge will always move in the direction in which it is experiencing the Coulomb's force. So you can always see that the Coulomb force will be divergent, because this is the force of repulsion. So anyways, we can understand that if there is a collection of same charges, it is automatically a bag filled with high potential energy. This is what we try to understand from this illustration. So as I said, that we need a potential drop or a potential gap or a potential difference to actually electric current to happen. So now we understand how are we going to create this. We will be having a place or a point in which we'll have lot of correction of positive charges, or it can be other way, it can be correction of negative charges. Now when I draw this one only in isolation, this itself means there is no point now creating another, you know, large Q or something like that. That itself means that this is a point or this is an area of high potential, and anywhere around its surrounding it is an area of low electric potential, because if let free, all these charges will move out in any direction. So this is how we create the potential difference between one point and any other point. So that was the first thing, that now we have created the potential difference. Now the big question is, in any material, how are we going to have free charges, or more specifically free electrons, because you know protons are nucleons, they are bound in the nucleus. It is only electron which is always available to move inside the material or around in the material itself. So how are we going to have, and in what way these charges are free to move within the material? So the other point is availability of free charge. One more thing, there can be a recap. Suppose we have let's say 10 charges in this package. Now if one charge come out from this, and now it is here, now we have 9 here and 1 here. Second charge will experience lesser tendency to come out from this box, because now it is repelled only by the 8 charges there. Initially there were 10 charge, so one charge was having or experiencing the force due to the 9 charges. Now there are 9 charges only, and every charge will have only 8 charges, 8 positive charges to repel it. So now there is a lesser tendency to come out from this box, or there is a lesser force of repulsion. And on the contrary, now to come at this side, because this is also a positive charge, so it will try to repel the charge which tries to come here. Suppose this charge now tries to come here. So this will be lesser repelled by this box, which is now having lesser charges. And this will be having some repulsion by this charge which is already here at the other pole. So subsequent or successive, you know, movement of charge will have lesser tendency, which means the potential difference drops as the current flows, because the tendency to move from one point to other point was due to that potential difference. Now when I say that the tendency is decreasing, automatically I mean to say that the potential difference between these two points is decreasing, because if we have potential difference increasing, there will be more tendency for any charge to come from this box to this point. And it is not the case, because here the repulsion force is lesser, and here we have introduced a new repulsion force for the second charge to come. So Here comes there another point, which is not an absolute requirement, but this is an ideal requirement, that if we want a steady current, steady means with the current which remains constant in time or almost constant in time, it doesn't vary much in time, we call it a steady current. So to have a steady current, we should have this steady potential difference, which means a constant voltage. A constant voltage or a steady potential difference is required throughout the time, until we want these charges to flow. And as discussed previously, the only way to do this is, the moment first charge comes from this point to this point, we have to recycle this back to this place, so that now again this is free and you don't have any charge here. Now you don't have any charge here, and again it is 10 here. So 1 comes here, again you have this thing. So 9 and 1, this one goes here. So it is a kind of system in which, you know, the charges are moving and charges are again pushed up. And now, you know, to push a charge from this place to this place will need energy, because already you have a lot of positive charge here, and this energy is supplied by a electrical pump, or we call it electrical generator, because it is generating this energy gap or the potential difference or voltage. So to have a steady current, we need such a pump which would recycle all the charge that are moving and reaching the other point, so that all these charges are pushed back to the higher potential and the potential difference is almost maintained and you have a steady current flow. So that is one thing. But in any case, if we do not have this, like in case of alternating current also, we have a current always flowing, though it's not steady in its intensity, that we'll do later. So that was one more thing. So we were discussing that how are we going to ensure the availability of free charge, because unless we have the charge that is free to move in a material, the electric current is not going to happen, even if we have a potential difference, because practically electron moves from one to another point. And now we say that the movement should only be under influence of the potential difference, which means they should be free from all other influences. If they have other influences, then it will not be a final movement only because of the potential difference. So we need free charge, free electrons or free charge carriers. Now based upon the availability of charge, different type of currents are termed or coined, and they are based upon different concepts. They happen in different material, they happen in different situations, they have some similarities but they have some dissimilarities also, because the charge carrier and the availability of charge carrier depends upon different concepts. So based upon the availability of charge carrier, we divide the current or the conduction in the most common and most easy to understand, most obvious to see is metallic current or metallic conduction. So we can say metallic current or metallic conduction. This is by and large also known as ohmic, because this obeys the Ohm's law. So this is one, the most common one. Then we have the electrolytic conduct current or electrolytic conduction. This is even seen in case of batteries or in cases where we have electrolytes or ions or in the body, you know, when we have a lot of electrolytes, we don't have metal in body. So this is also seen, but not easily related by common people. But metallic current is something which is very commonly, you know, seen and observed. So then the next one is electrolytic current or conduction. Third one is displacement current. So these are the three concepts, these are the three types of materials, and these are the three types of conductions which we are going to understand in the coming discussion. And one thing remains same, that the charge would move from one part to another part under influence of potential difference and would constitute current. But there are some dissimilarities, there are some similarities, and due to which these are named, coined and referred in different contexts. So we will be doing all these one by one. Another important feature in a circuit is, which is commonly referred, that we may have two type of circuits. One is constant voltage circuit and the other is constant current circuit. Let us take one example. Suppose we have a circuit in which you know, you have a potential difference creator or a source of energy, and then you have some you know, components, you have a switch here. So this is the circuit. Now As I have previously mentioned, that to maintain a steady current, you need a steady voltage. Now, if the voltage is not steady, the current is not going to be steady. So that is one thing. So now when we say that the charge moves from one point to another point, and we say that it is moving from higher potential to lesser potential, and here it was having more potential energy or electrical energy, and here it is going to lose some energy. Where is this energy going? This point, electron or the charge were having more energy. It moved from this place to some place, obviously towards the place of lesser energy, lesser electrical energy or lesser potential energy. Now, so in between, where does the energy go? So in general, in a circuit, we would say that the path which is taken by this electron would be having some resistance. We will be discussing this in details, but here to understand this concept, let us assume that when this electron was moving from this point to another point, it experienced some resistance, and to overcome that resistance, the energy was spent, and finally it reached here. The difference of potential energy from here to here is spent in combating or in overcoming this resistance. So this is one thing which is very basic, though the electric circuit is not there to waste this energy into resistance. Maybe this resistance is in the shape of some electric bulb which is glowing, so this is a resistance technically, but functionally or practically it is a bulb for us, or maybe it is a heating element, or you may have some other applications of electric current. So this resistance actually is not resistance, it is just a device which is, you know, functioning. But practically, there is a difference between saying that this is a resistance because it is a device. Actually, it is a resistance. So here it was having more energy, it lost its energy here, and with the lesser energy it reached this point. So this is the purpose of electric circuit, this is the purpose of making electric current flow, that we need to use. Remember, we had a pump which pushed electrons, or which pushed the charge here. So we had some energy, maybe some thermal energy was here, or maybe some wind energy was here, or some solar energy was here. So with all these different type of energies, we pushed the electrons, or we pushed the charge from a part of lower potential to higher potential. And now the same energy which is stored in this area of high potential is utilized in some different form. So initially, let's say it was a heat energy, and we obtained a bulb glow by this circuit. So we have converted the heat energy into light energy. Initially, let's say it was windmill or wind energy. So now we have converted the mechanical energy of wind into bulb to glow. So this is basically conversion, because energy cannot be created. So we are basically changing the forms of energy and we utilize them. And certain devices can only function with electric current. So we need electric current. Directly a wind or directly the heat will not be giving you this electric bulb glow. So we need a mechanism. So that is this. Now, as long as we have this resistance fixed, normally in most of the circuits we have a source, it can be a battery, or it can be, and we have a resistance, and the circuit is good enough to give you a function. So as long as this resistance is fixed, this and potential difference is maintained by this source. This is the source, this is the resistance, this is the key or the switch. So as long as this resistance is constant and the source maintains a constant potential difference, we are going to have a constant current. So in some circuits, we say that it is a constant voltage circuit. Now think of a situation in which, let's say, this resistance is variable. It is dynamic. Sometimes it takes a higher value, sometimes it takes a lesser value. So when we have such a situation, in such a situation, and the voltage is fixed, it is constant. So in such a situation, when you have a fixed voltage, but the resistance is dynamic, resistance of the circuit is variable, we are going to have its effect on the current. So the current will be variable. So a current constant voltage circuit may have variable current, and in case of a fixed resistance, it can have a constant current also. So that depends basically on the resistance. But in a variable resistance circuit, a constant voltage circuit will always have variable current with some analogy, and then we'll come back to this. So let us understand a real life situation, and then we'll come back to the electric circuit. Assume that there is a roadway which is 100 km in length, in distance, and this roadway is bad. The route is bumpy, it has a lot of bad patches, good speed cannot be maintained, and due to all these factors, the fuel efficiency comes out to be 20 km per liter. which means the vehicle would be able to travel 20 kilometers only in 1 liter of fuel. So in such a case, the fuel required to cross this whole roadway and to come at this point would be 5 liters. So this is the requirement of the fuel. Now, since this road is going to be 100 kilometer only, we are not going to make this road bad or worse, and we are not going to improve this also. So we assume that this is going to be the fuel efficiency throughout the period, and there is a person who is filling fuel to all these lorries that are waiting here, and assuming that this is going to like this only, he would give 5 liter of fuel to all of its vehicles, and these vehicles will be able to clear this place, and they will all be here in 5 liters of fuel, because this is what we have assumed. So this is a kind of situation which is constant voltage. The energy is constant, a constant figure is given, and in that constant figure they are able to match the requirement. And if you see this point, you can see same amount of vehicles are coming, because same amount of fuel is given, same amount of fuel is consumed, so same amount of vehicle would come here. Now we have a twist here now to understand the case. So this was case one. Let us further assume that this is one part, that this road is bumpy, this road is bad. Now I try to give you another situation, which is case two, in the similar context but slightly changed. What do we do now, or what do we assume now, is that in addition to this road's length and this road's fuel efficiency, now we have some dynamic factors also. Suppose a herd of sheep come around sometime in between this road. We say that this road is traversed by some stray animals, and stray animals at random come. Sometimes they come, sometimes they do not come. So sometimes you will find some stray animals here, sometimes you do not see. But this guy does not know this thing, and stray animals can be taken as another resistance, because the vehicle, which is already going with a low speed because of a bad and bumpy road, we have to brake it further to make the way clear for the stray animals, or to find its way between the stray animals. So we can assume that now the speed will be even lesser if we have stray animals, but it is not there for all the vehicles. We have, let's say, 10-15 vehicles here. So some vehicles just cross it, some vehicles would not be able to cross it because this guy is only giving 5 liters of fuel. Now the driver or the vehicle which does not come across any stray animal will be able to clear this area, and you will find a lorry here. We are discussing case 2. But for the vehicle where you have, let's say, 2 or 3 herds of stray animals in between in this 100 kilometers of length, definite, and because the fuel is only given for 5 liters, they will be short of fuel and they will not be able to realize this point. Somewhere in between they will fall short of fuel and they will not be able to match the target. So in this case, I would say if 10 lorries are starting from here, maybe only 7 are reaching here. 10 lorries started from here, only 7 reached in case 2, because 2-3 lorries ran out of fuel because they wasted some fuel due to the stray animals which impeded or resisted their already low speed. And in case 1, 10 lorries were seen here and 10 lorries could complete, and they were seen here. So you can see that if a resistance is constant, constant voltage can maintain this constant current. But if the resistance is variable, you know, sometimes you have a stray animal, sometimes you do not have. Road is bumpy, that is a constant part. But variable part is now that some stray animals are coming, sometimes they are coming in more number, sometimes they are coming in less number, so all these things. So in the next case, this fuel given is insufficient in some cases, and you do not see same amount of vehicle turning up at the final point. So now, how do you manage this situation? So for such a situation, let's say we have a monitor here. Someone is having a large platform or a long, high platform on which someone is standing, and he is looking, he is putting a vigil in this whole area. And if they find that some herd of animal is approaching to this highway, they would give information to this fuel man that gives some more fuel because some stray animals are seen approaching this highway. And when he finds that there is no stray animal near or slightly farther also from this highway, he would say that only 5 liters of fuel is sufficient, highway is clear. This can be an example of road traffic jam also. Any example of it, which means a dynamic situation is here, and for a dynamic situation we need a monitor, we need a vigilance, a real-time vigilance which will give feedback to this fuel van so that either 5 liter or more than 5 liter of fuel is given to the vehicle, such that all vehicles, not 10 to 7, 10 to 10, which means if 10 are starting from here, 10 would go here. But now in this case, all 10 are not getting 5 liters of fuel. Some are getting more fuel because the fuel man was fed with this information that more fuel would be required because there are some stray animals that I can see on the highway. So I mean to say that if you want to maintain constant current, either you should have a constant resistance and a constant voltage, you can maintain as in the case 1. Resistance is constant. According to resistance, you have calculated the fuel and you have a 10 to 10 input and output. So that is constant voltage. But when we have a dynamic circuit like this, in which the resistance is dynamic, we need a feedback mechanism and we need more fuel, such that more fuel or ideal fuel can be given, but the output should not change. It should remain 10 only all the time. Now this feedback is given by a feedback transistor. It's an electronic device which senses the change in the value of current, and the moment it senses that the current value is changing, it will feed the potential difference generator or the source of the circuit that please give more potential difference because more current is required because the current is dropping. So the current will not drop, the voltage would change, the fuel will change, but the efficiency would not drop. So we have two type of circuits, and these two circuits are seen in different situations.